and a poet. This is going to be a bit unusual. We begin with Gagan Gill. I'm going to ask her a few questions to sort of provide a context for her poems. She'll read some of her poems, both in Hindi and in English, the translations in English. And then we move on to Ranjini, who will read, I think, two Jataka stories. And if we have time, from her translation of a poem from Sinhala, Yashodhara, or the wife of the Buddha. Gagan Gill is an acclaimed poet. She has published 4 collections of poetry and 2 volumes of prose. She gave up a very successful career in journalism to be a poet full time. Here I quote from her translator, Lucy Rosenstein. She left her job in journalism in order to secure long periods of silence in her everyday life, which she considered necessary to remain truly connected to words. It sounds Buddhist already. In 2011, Gagan took vows to be a lay Buddhist sadhika. She's never actually talked about it in public. This will be the first time that she'll be talking about it. Gagan, you don't actually, from our previous discussion, see yourself as a Buddhist poet. You describe yourself in very precise terms as a poet with a Buddhist heart. What does that mean? Is a poet's heart different from a Buddhist's heart?
There is a Buddhist prayer. Sit in a corner and meditate on yourself as if you were a wounded animal. So in that much, I think a poet's heart and a Buddhist heart are one and the same. But where I feel a Buddhist heart seeks out a different release for itself is that it doesn't want to just circle around that area of pain, that area of darkness, which triggers a poem, but it wants to find a better understanding of the self, of the situation, in bigger scheme of things. So you are inching closer to more peace. A Buddhist heart doesn't mean that you are at peace already. The Buddhist heart is the most troubled heart, but it is the heart which is aware, it is restless, and it is seeking a peace within.
Do you think that your poems had a Buddhist element to them before you actually took your vows? Is there a connection between the formal sort of nature of your investment in Buddhism and?
Well, I wasn't aware of it in the beginning. I think some element was always there. It was like an old memory. I think all of us carry some old memories from another time. It was like that. But now that I have formally crossed over and I read back, I look back at my stuff, I am surprised how my heart was a Buddhist even before I knew the Buddha. And the Jatakas, the elements of Jatakas, not the narrative, but the element of Jataka was just coming into the poem without my even knowing it. Like in one of the poems, it said, Devta guzarte hain kabhi kabhi mere bheetar se koi prachin dukh jilane. And I didn't know how I had written this, but one of the critics connected it with the great renunciation story of the Buddha, that when the Buddha was going normally about his life and not showing any signs of seeking or any signs of fulfilling his destiny, then the gods garbed themselves as a sick man, a mendicant, an old person. And this is how he recovered his memory and he set out. So I wonder if those little elements were coming there. I went through a long period of inconsolable grief. I think all of us lose people in the course of our lives, our very dear ones, and all of us get over them. But in this one, I think those were the things which slowly brought Buddha into my poems, and I was aware of his more pronounced presence in the poems. In fact, when they scheduled me in this session, I was very diffident because Buddhism and Buddha is the secret of my heart. I didn't know what am I going to do here. But I thought, since Buddha is very much a part of my writing, it is time when I read things which were conspicuously about him.
Well, thank you. It's good to know that you're doing it here and with us. Could you tell us a little about your collection of poems, the Andhirime Buddha? That is, I think, Buddhas in the Dark.
Hmm.
Because I think that's also one reason why you're part of this session and all that.
I think the persona of Buddha rattles most of us's hearts. And irrespective of whether we are able to articulate it, give it the words, you know, the life story of Buddha, more than what he attained later on. Because it is the troubled heart we identify with ourselves. It is a heartbreaking story all through what he himself goes through and what other people who are attached to him go through. For me, more than the fact that he renounced everything or he went on to find a moment of enlightenment, the most moving moment for me in Buddha's life remains when after his first bhiksha, he's sitting with his pot and looking at all this mixed food in the bowl, and he feels nauseated by the sight of it because he was a prince, and he looks at it and he cringes. He's not sure whether he wants to eat it. I find it so moving. I find it as critical a moment in his life as perhaps fighting with the Lord of Temptation many years later. You know, this victory over taste and but I have issues. I have issues with the Buddha. If my heart follows him, then I also stay back with Yashodhara. I'm very happy when she refuses to accept him back or go and receive him. She says that let him come and visit me. He's the one who abandoned me. And I feel I have found the Buddha
with a woman's heart. I want to understand his path through the heart of Yashodhara, who was abandoned, who was rejected, who followed him all through. And I read feminist interpretations of the fact that he didn't want women to be part of the order. But the historical fact is that 6 years into his enlightenment and setting up the sanghas, after great resistance, he did agree to allow his abandoned wife, his foster mother, and a whole lot of family women to enter the order. And what he says at that moment, that now the Sangha will not survive more than 500 years. I don't understand the terms of anti-feminist statement. I take it as an acknowledgement of the tenderness he was still aware of that existed between him and Yashodhara. You know, that strong bond which he knew that if he, as the Buddha, could find so difficult to get over, the lesser mortals would really be giving in to that thing. I find that very, I mean, this is where he becomes tangible, where he becomes very personal to me. I'm not too, irrespective of this, that I finally went and took my vows as a Buddhist practitioner, but I think I have, no, like you love someone and you have all those fights, I still have many issues to sort out in my heart.
But from what I know and from what I've read, this Andhirime Buddha is the product of a certain event in your life which led to a series of poems. Okay. And you don't actually encounter the Buddha directly in the poems, if I understand.
Yeah, actually, that was the time when we lost a small child in the family. Mm-hmm. And I always, I've written a series of poems on that. Niece of mine we lost. It was very difficult time. And I'm surprised how Buddha just came into the poems. He didn't send me to look for a seed of mustard, that you go and look for a seed of mustard and you will know that death visits every place. But somehow the series of Andhirime Buddha started. He started coming into my poems like a statue, and then he became a person, and then I could see him in different, moments of great incidental value.
Should we go on to read the poems, if that's all right? Your poems?
So I just want to read about the Buddha poems, and I want to read most of them in original, but as I feel, I'll just move from the Hindi originals to translations. Andhere mein Buddh अपनी प्रतिमा से निकलते हैं, अपनी काया से निकलते हैं, अपने स्तूप से निकलते हैं, अस्थिपुंज से निकलते हैं। अंधेरे में बुद्ध परिक्रमा करते हैं माया की, मोक्ष की, पृथ्वी की। कांटे के नोक पर अंधेरे में ठिठकते हैं बुद्ध। दुख उनके लिए है जो उसे मानते हैं, दुख उनके लिए भी है जो उसे नहीं मानते। सिर नवाते हैं, अगरबत्ती जलाते हैं सामने उसके, जो है जो नहीं है। अंधेरे में बुद्ध अपनी जगह बदलते हैं, एक प्रतिमा से दूसरी प्रतिमा तक, एक मुद्रा से दूसरी मुद्रा तक, जैसे उनकी नहीं दुख की जगह हो। This is a poem, again I'm tempted to read it in Hindi. It says, he would come and stand outside our dreams. करवट बदलते ही ऐसा लगता था जैसे अभी अभी कोई यहाँ था। हमारी नींद में हमारे पीछे जाने कौन से दैत्य लगे होते। अक्सर एक जंगल होता जिसमें हम भागते, छुपने को कोई घर न मिलता कि हमें शरण देने वाले घरों को, जो दरवाजे लगने थे वो अभी भी जंगल में पेड़ थे। बिस्तर पर शिथिल हमारी देह स्वप्नरत होती, उसे कोई भी दबोच लेता, देवता या दैत्य। हम नहीं जाते थे उनकी शरण में, स्वप्न तक में। ऐसे में अक्सर वह हमारे स्वप्नों के बाहर आ खड़ा रहता था। आधी रात लोग कहते थे तथागत। वन लिटिल रेफरेंस टू इट इज दैट दे से दैट इट वाज द प्रैक्टिस ऑफ द बुद्धा that every night before he went to sleep, he would visit with his divine eyes all the creatures in the universe and send them his karuna. And I believe that his karuna continues to visit us even now. I'll read this one in translation. This is about Yashodhara. She still sleeps in the ruins. Your hand that paused that day on the bosom of a woman is still there. The God who passed that night near the faces of your woman, near your body, turned you impotent, is still there. They have still not found your body. The ants of Kapilvastu, they wander homeless. Your hunger of many days, it wanders too, hiding from you in your father's alleys. The woman you left behind, sleeping in the wilderness of that palace, is still there. She is still asleep with her newborn in the ruins. As those who can
tell the difference between the two languages. I'll read it now in Hindi. स्त्री के वक्ष पर रखा तुम्हारा हाथ ठिठक गया था उस दिन, वो अब भी यहाँ है। ठहरा था एक ईश्वर जो उस रात तुम्हारी स्त्रियों के मुख पर तुम्हारी अपुरुष हुई देह में अचानक, वह अब भी यहाँ है। अभी तक नहीं मिली तुम्हारी देह कपिल वस्तु की चींटियों को, भटकती हैं वो, भटकती हैं तुम्हारी कई दिनों की भूख, चली आई है वह तुमसे छिपकर पिता की इन गलियों में। So I really, as I heard somebody in the morning, I have to eat the mic. स्त्री जो सो रही थी महल के एकांत में उस दिन अपने नवजात के संग, अभी तक सो रही है खंडहर में। This is Sujata ka ann. जितने दानों पर लगी थी योगी की मोहर, उतने ही जाते हैं उसके भीतर, उतने ही पका पाती है सुजाता, उतने ही ढलते हैं उसके बर्तन में, उतने ही दानों के आश्रय काटता है 49 दिन ध्यानरत योगी, उतने ही होते हैं पर्याप्त समझाने को उसे सृष्टि का मर्म। अंतिम है ये भोज, दिस इज द लास्ट फीस्ट, धूमिल पड़ जाएगी इसकी स्मृति भी, गड्ढमड्ढ हो जाएंगे तरह तरह के अन्न भिक्षा पात्र में, घूमता रहेगा एक ईश्वर होने न होने के बीच, ऐसे तो नहीं आता कोई पृथ्वी पर, ऐसे तो नहीं भटकता कोई बिना ईश्वर। The poems of Andhere Mein Buddha led to another phase, poems for a monk, because very interestingly in the last poem of Andhere Mein Buddha had a nun sitting at the back of the congregation and chanting, I won't let you go, I won't let you go. I'll just read one poem from that series for those of my friends who are in robes here. I just want to refer to this test they have in monasteries, where before converting a small child to monastic vows, they take a test. The child is supposed to shoo away a crow. If the child has been able to shoo away a crow, then he is old enough to be given the to be ordained. But is that all? This is a poem in which a crow from a previous birth is following the novice. कोई नहीं रुकेगा, जितने को उड़ाओगे सब चले जाएंगे, बैठ जाएंगे जाकर किसी दूसरे जन्म की शिला पर, फिर से करने लगेंगे तुम्हारी प्रतीक्षा। एक होगा लेकिन जो कहीं नहीं जाएगा, रुके रहने को अदृश्य हो जाएगा,
तुम्हारे संग लगा रहेगा हरदम, धूप और बारिश में, स्मृति और विस्मृति में। ठंडे बिस्तर में जाओगे तुम और गर्म कर रखी होगी उसने तुम्हारी जगह। सिर्फ किसी किसी दिन तुम्हें शक होगा, रुक जाओगे तुम अचानक आकाश के नीचे बीच पर्वत पर, जैसे कुछ पूछा हो किसी ने। नहीं, यह स्मृति पर्वत नहीं है। जो मांगते हैं उत्तर, वह दिखते नहीं है।
I think this yes. is the same. Thank you. Now to Ranjini Obeyesekere. She taught English at the departments of California and San Diego, and she spent 10 years in Princeton University as a lecturer in anthropology, where she lectured on South Asian literature and culture. Her published books include works on criticism, on Sri Lankan theater, Buddhist literature in Sri Lanka, and she also has a collection of short stories. There's a book called Portraits of Buddhist Women, which is a collection of short stories about women from a 13th century Buddhist work. And there's also a really fascinating translation of two works from Sri Lanka, Sinhala works, on Yashodhara. It's called Yashodhara, the Wife of the Bodhisattva. And I think Ranjini might read from it if we have time. But she's first going to read two Jataka tales.
Good afternoon. I'm going to read just two brief stories from the Jatakas. As the Dalai Lama said, many of us came to Buddhism through stories, through the Jatakas. And they were fun for us to read and enjoy. And the message came to us perhaps later in life, but somewhere along the line, over the years, I've read and reread them, and they have been very meaningful for me. So today I chose two stories. One is a very simple, short one about a monkey and the encounter with the Bodhisattva. And the other is a longer story. I don't know whether we will have time for it, but they both, for me, deal with a single theme. And maybe after I read the story, we can discuss the theme. This is a translation from the 13th century text from Sri Lanka of the Jatakas. And ironically, the story goes that the Jatakas were first written down in Sri Lanka in around the first century BC. Subsequently, they were translated into Pali in around the 5th century and written in Pali. The Sri Lankan texts then were lost over time. And in the 14th century, a Buddhist monk translated the Pali text back into Sinhala. And today, or this year, we have begun to translate the 14th century text into English to see whether it reaches a wider audience. Okay, here is the simple story. And I'm cutting out the sort of framing context which comes with every Buddhist Jataka. Long ago, when a king named Brahmadatta ruled in the city of Baranas, the Bodhisattva was born to a Brahmin clan in the Kasi region. He renounced the pleasures of the five senses and lived the life of an ascetic. At that time, there was a severe drought affecting an area along a road. Many birds suffered without water. If people happened to pass by, they would receive a little water from the passersby. If there were no people passing by, they got no water. For a long time now, no man had walked on that road, so many birds suffered without water. A certain monkey was sitting near a water hole, waiting for someone to come and give him some water. At the time, the Bodhisattva happened to go along the road on business and came to the water hole. there, he drew some water, and as the monkey was there, he gave him some water too. The monkey, after drinking his fill, climbed up a tree and started mocking and jeering at the bodhisattva. I gave water to the likes of you, and you now mock me? There is no gratitude to be found in a base creature, said the bodhisattva. Where have you found anyone of our kind being grateful for any help received? Asked the monkey. Besides, this is not all. I will now shit on your head too before I leave, he said. Yes, it is true that that is what base creatures do, said the bodhisattva, leaving. The monkey watched from a branch above, saw the bodhisattva coming towards him, excreted on his head, and then left. The bodhisattva, without any malice towards the monkey, washed his hair, bathed, and went on his way. The Buddha then concluded the Dutiya Makkata Jataka thus. The monkey at the time is now the senior monk Devadatta. The ascetic was me, now the Buddha, he said. And that's the story. So it's a very simple story. And it shows how the bodhisattva's reaction, there are some things that you cannot help. It's not worth getting upset about and angry about. If people are, you know, nasty, why bother? Just wash your head and go along the way. So that's one very simple story. Do I have time for another one? I don't know. Okay, the other is a longer story. And it's called The Story of the Virtuous Elephant, Silavanagaraja Jataka. Once long ago, when a king named Brahmadatta ruled in the city of Varanasi, all the stories happened where Brahmadatta ruled in Varanasi, even though it goes over centuries. Our great Bodhisattva was born as an elephant in the Himalayan forest. That Bodhisattva, even as he was emerging from his mother's womb, was fully white. He was like a lump of silver. His eyes shone with the five pleasing aspects and glittered like two blue sapphires. His mouth was like a golden carpet. His trunk was like a silver chain decorated with gold patterns. His feet shone as if they were colored with lac. That Bodhisattva's body was extremely beautiful as a consequence of the 10 perfections he had cultivated in past births. He became renowned, and all the elephants in the Himalayan forest became his attendants. Thus, that Bodhisattva lived in the Himalayan forest in the company of 80,000 elephants. However, after some time, having realized the drawbacks of living in the company of herds, he distanced himself and lived alone in the forest. The Bodhisattva came to be known as Silavanagaraja, the virtuous elephant king, as he was virtuous. At that time, a forest dweller went to the Himalayan forest in search of some object he could sell in order to make a living. In the forest, he lost his way and, unable to figure out the right direction, wandered about, clasping his head in his hands and crying out in fear. The Bodhisattva heard his lamentations and approached him. The man was terrified and ran away. As he ran, the Bodhisattva remained still, unmoving. The man then stopped once again. Again, the man started to run away. Then the Bodhisattva began to approach him again. Again, the man started to run away, but stopped when he saw the Bodhisattva do likewise. He thought, this king of elephants does not mean to harm me. He must be trying to help me and save me from this plight. He then stood where he was, boldly and without fear. The Bodhisattva went to him and said, good man, why do you wander weeping like this? Master, unable to find my way and scared to death, I wander like this, crying in fear, he answered. Good man, do not be afraid. I will take you to where humans live. The Bodhisattva said, and placing the man on his back, he started to walk in that direction. That treacherous man, a betrayer of friends, while riding on the elephant's back, took careful note of the trees, rocks, etc., as markers in the event that someone were to ask him the way. The Bodhisattva, having taken that treacherous man out of the jungle, put him on the road to the city of Varanasi and said to him, good man, follow this road. Do not tell anyone about me, even if someone were to ask you. The Bodhisattva then returned to his forest dwelling. The man returned to the city, and while walking along the city streets, passing the street of ivory workers, he met a craftsman and asked, good friend, if I bring you the tusks of a living elephant, will you buy them? What do you mean, man? Jiva danta, live elephant tusk? Ivory is much more valuable than those from dead ones, said the craftsman. If that is so, I'll bring you jiva danta, ivory, said the man. And with these words, he took a sharp saw and returned to the dwelling place of the Bodhisattva. The Bodhisattva saw him return and asked, why have you come back? I'm desperate. I'm poor. I have no way of making a living. If you give me a piece of your tusk, I could take it, sell it, and I would be able to live on that money. I came back for this purpose, said the man. Our great Bodhisattva listened to him and said, let it be so. I will give you the tusk. But do you have a saw to cut it? Yes, sir, I have brought a saw, said the man. If so, cut and take away a piece of the tusks. So saying, the Bodhisattva knelt down and then lay on his chest. That evil man cut off the ends of the two tusks. The Bodhisattva took the two pieces of tusk in his trunk and said, good man, I am not giving away these pieces of tusk because I do not like or value them. However, the tusks of omniscient knowledge that enable one to understand all phenomena will be 1,000 times or 100,000 times more valuable to me than these tusks. Therefore, it is with this intention that I give away the tusks. Then the Bodhisattva made a fervent wish, saying, may this gift of my tusks enable me to attain to that all-knowing wisdom. And then he gave the man his tusks as surety for obtaining that wisdom. That treacherous evil fellow took the tusks and, having spent the money earned by selling them, returned to the Bodhisattva once again. Master, the income obtained by selling your tusks was sufficient just to settle my loans. Therefore, please give me the remaining part of your tusks. Well, let it be so, said the Bodhisattva again. He got the remaining parts cut off and gave them to him. The man sold those pieces and came back as before and said, Master, I can't make a living. Can you give me also the root of the tusks? Very well, said the great Bodhisattva, and offered the tusks. That man, ascending the head of the great elephant that was like Mount Kailasha, stepping on his trunk that was like a silver chain, clearing the roots of the tusks by squeezing them with his soles, tried hard to cut the root tusk with his saw. Then the Bodhisattva, seeing that he was tired and unable to cut the tusks, helped him by holding one end of the saw with his trunk. The man cut off the very roots of the tusks and took them away. Just a little while after that man had taken away the tusks, the great earth, 240,000 yojana in extent, despite the fact that it could bear the burden of mountains such as Sumeru and Yugandhara, and all the repulsive urine and excreta, etc., of the world, was unable to bear the weight of the great Bodhisattva's virtues and cracked open. Suddenly, flames rose up from Avicii Hill through that crevice, wrapped around that evil man as if it were a red carpet, and dragged him down to hell. Thus, when that evil man entered the earth, the deity living in the forest said, "An ungrateful, evil person will not be satisfied, even if he's made a universal monarch." The deity preached a sermon so as to be heard throughout the forest. The bodhisattva lived his lifespan, died, and was reborn according to his karma. Okay. I chose the two stories because they both deal with the theme of ingratitude, but the scale is totally different. One is just a kind of habit, a trifle by comparison. The monkey is just a monkey. This is what he does. And why waste time scolding him or getting angry with him or doing anything about it? Just bathe yourself, wash it off, and go along your way. The other one is the most serious levels of ingratitude. It is greed and ingratitude in an incremental order that trap the hunter and faced and force him to go back again and again and again. And the bodhisattva realizes it, but his approach is one of, okay, he wants it, I will give it. Not because I do not value it, but I am giving it. And this incremental thing is of such a horrendous nature. The quality of the ingratitude is so horrendous that the earth cannot bear it and falls, breaks open and sucks the man in. I mean, this is a story ending, but it is in a sense a statement of the difference of degree and the intensity of the reaction that follows that kind of intensity. So I read these just to balance each other out.
If there are questions, we can take them.
So I'm particularly interested in the second story. Mm-hmm. It seems also a story of great selflessness. And I'm trying to relate it to my own world. I come from a business background. Mm-hmm. I confront management issues and people issues on an ongoing basis. And one of the things you try to do as you have more responsibility within a large organization is to prevent a situation ever arising where the earth falls apart. That's mm-hmm. part of what I'm paid to do. So I'm interested, within Buddhism, are there also stories of where you're having to make judgments on the mm-hmm. extent to which you allow, you give people a bit of rope, because mm-hmm. you don't cut them too early. You want to give them the chance to redeem themselves. Mm-hmm. But there's a certain point at which you step in and stop because it's for the good of greater society.
Well, there are 546 Jataka stories, and I'm sure you'll find an answer to your question there. But just to say that the point that for me came out of these two stories is that there are degrees at which intervention may be necessary. And there are degrees at which the range is so horrendous that the earth intervenes with some cataclysmic event. But in between, from the little monkey to this elephant and the generosity with which he gave his tusks and the ingratitude with which it was received and the search for power and greed and which carried this man on and on and on until the very earth could not bear it. So that's the range, and I'm sure you'll find hundreds of examples as you go along.
The gentleman over there.
I'm taking a cue from both of you. You mentioned about the saga not surviving for more than 500 years once women joined. And similarly, like you said, a monkey can do it. Man is capable of much more. And there is a sense in the Jataka stories that inevitably, when he's interpreting the dreams of a king also, he says his teenage pregnancies. Mm-hmm. Teenage pregnancies, he talked of it, the Buddha talked of it at that time. And also of seven sons descending on the earth and so on. There is a sense of inevitability that ultimately we are all heading for a Holocaust sort of a situation. Do you get that sense when you interpret the stories?
Would you like to answer it?
No, I'll first listen.
Okay. The sense of a Holocaust situation that we're all facing, I think, is something we all face with the environmental destruction, the melting of the icebergs, the growing of, these are all things that we are, maybe not our generation, maybe 10 generations ahead, could happen, and we're not unaware of it. But the stories, I think, are stories that have evolved over centuries and deal with issues that have to be interpreted both in context as well as in terms of our world. And as I told this young lady here, maybe the fact that this range from the monkey to the elephant, and where you put the stop, and at what point do you react, and what point do you not react, and if you don't react for that much, is it that the earth will collapse under you? So that's the kind of range, and I don't get your question, but the fact that the Buddha is supposed to have said that by bringing in the nuns, the order will not last as much as it would be with the monks. You have to also remember it in context. This was the 5th century BC. His was the first order, religious order, that included women. And the fact that he was working in a culture where it would be very hard to accept was probably one of the reasons why he refused once, twice, thrice. But the Buddha, from the stories we get, I mean, we only know it from the texts that we come, is that he always adjusted his rules, his positions, even with the monks and the Vinaya rules. If some monk said, this is not good, this doesn't work for us, he would change it. It wasn't as if there were hard and fast laws that existed forever. And so with the women, once he realized that there was pressure, there was, these 500 women had come begging him to allow them to be ordained, and he himself believed that any woman, male or female, it doesn't matter, any person who has the intellectual ability or the interest or the power to make use of his doctrine and reach the other end, they are capable of doing it. He said it's only a vehicle, it's only a means to an end, not an end in itself. And so he changed his laws. I mean, he changed his rules. There was a situation where a monk was raped in the forest, and they came to him and said, you know, this kind of thing happens. We live alone, we live isolated lives in the forest. And he immediately made another rule to say that groups of nuns have to live within certain boundaries, within certain spaces, so that they're not vulnerable to this kind of attack. And it's a very open religion. For me, Buddhism is an open religion. It is something for me myself to come to terms with and use it in order to live my life. And so there are no hard and fast rules. And if the Buddha at that time said it will only last 500, if there are women, he was probably anticipating the kind of possibilities that occurred. And just to tell you an example, as I said this morning, in Sri Lanka, the Buddhist order that was established, the Buddhist order of nuns, bhikkhunis, established by Sangamitra in the 3rd century BC, in the time of Asoka, died out completely by the 11th century AD. To this day, there have been no bhikkhunis to keep the order going. They now have had to go to, I think, China or Korea, I'm not sure where the Theravada Institute of Bhikkhunis exists and have been reordained. So the order collapsed. Similarly with the Sri Lankan order of monks. By the 14th century, there were no monks. According to, they got sent to Siam, the king sent to Siam to get monks, to reordain and reestablish the order of monks. So like everything else, it's subject to change, and I think he was just anticipating that.
I just want to add a little bit to, if I got your question right. The biggest astounding example for us in 20th, 21st century of a nation surviving a Holocaust-like situation in the light of Buddhist teachings is Tibet. The kind of genocide that has taken place, the kind of routine violation that has that the people have been subjected to there, inside and also outside. You know, you enter the larger world, and all you have is this faith in your heart and this constant struggle to keep the flame going. Those people have survived remarkably, as you hear the encounters of people who were in jails, in Chinese jails. One of the monks who was brutally subjected to all the electric rods and all, when later on he was freed and he had an audience with the Dalai Lama, the Dalai Lama asked him, what was the biggest test you were subjected to? And he said, when they used to torture me with electric rods, every day I used to pray for them that may I continue to have this compassion for them. So the Buddhist teaching has has withstood its test among the practitioners of the faith.
We have time for, I think, two questions, perhaps one.
Hi, I'm just curious to know about the Buddhist perspective on ambition. Because I don't know too much about Buddhism, but whatever I do know, it's about denouncement. And even the Buddha himself, though he was a king, denounced and never went back to rule his kingdom. While he could have done that, being an enlightened soul, he could have been detached. And so does Buddhism have a perspective on ambition and acquisition in the world while being detached?
It depends on what you consider ambition. I suppose you can say that the Buddha had a commitment to achieve a goal of finding the answers to the problem of human suffering. And so he was willing to renounce A and B and C along the path in order to get to that end. So in a sense, you can interpret it and say that was his ambition. Not that it was his ambition for himself. And that, I think, is where you would make the distinction in the term ambition, as opposed to commitment to a cause or commitment to an idea of, or an ideal, or just an answer to a question. And that, I think, is how you can see the Buddha. It wasn't that he was ambitious, he wanted to become a Buddha to become a world conqueror or X, Y, or Z or whatever. He just wanted for himself to find the answer to human suffering. And so he was willing to commit himself to go through all the necessary processes in which to reach that goal, even if it meant giving up his royal pleasures, giving up the wife he loved, giving up his newborn child in order to... There's a wonderful verse in a folk poem, the Yasodharavata. I don't think I can find it in a hurry, where he says he's about to say goodbye to his wife. Somebody can take a question, I'll see whether I can come up with the verse.
But I just wanted to add to this question of ambition, that according to the Buddhist texts, once he attained enlightenment, one of the last attacks on him by the Lord of Temptation, Mara, was to keep him quiet, to tempt him into silence, that he should not share his moment of enlightenment with the rest of the people. And it took the Buddha some time to realize that this was the doing of the Lord of Temptation. Before Tathagat came, before we came to know that there was a Lord like Tathagat, according to the historical records, they say there were 24 Buddhas, historical Buddhas, who had been tempted into silence. So there goes the ambition vis-a-vis the moment of enlightenment.
Yes, I think the fact that there were always two kinds of Buddhas. There was the Pacheka Buddha, as well as the Buddha who taught. The Pacheka Buddha was someone who attained enlightenment and decided that that was it. In the case of the Buddha of this of our time, and there were many Buddhas according to the texts, of course, he made a conscious decision, while it was tempting to just end it then and there, it was also a challenge that he would try to teach the doctrine and help others to reach this escape from suffering. I mean, still haven't found the verse, so maybe you can have
an answer. Even till this day, I think in our part of the world, in our tradition, it is felt cheapening your moment of great experience if you ever choose to talk about it. If you have had a big moment in your life, you're supposed to hold it very dear in your heart.
Thank you, Gagan. Thank you, Ranjini.
I'll just read those two verses, because they might make some sense to you. The Bodhisattva goes to see his sleeping wife on the night that he decides to leave. And this is a folk poet's recreation of that scene. And it's very powerful in its own ways. He sees his wife and he says, "You wept more..." He's talking about Yasodhara. He hasn't entered her room. "You wept more tears for me than the seas hold water. Does this wide world hold a woman as good as you? Today, I leave you. In order to become a Buddha, I must destroy desire, be firm in my resolve. For one wife and one child, shall I give up my quest or save countless creatures from the samsaric round? No, today I leave all I love, become an ascetic. What a radiant, lovely child is my Rahula." Now that last line is again the human Bodhisattva, resolved, trying to make up his mind, trying not to get himself moved away from the quest. And yet, he sees his little child and he says, "What a radiant, lovely child is my Rahula."
Thank you, Ranjini. Thank you, Gagan, for the wonderful readings and the really interesting discussion. We have to wind up. Thank you, everybody.
Thank you, everyone. The authors will be available.